Attract what you expect. Reflect what you desire. Become what you respect. And mirror what you admire. With this amazing thought, greetings to all for today. And I hope, my dear students, that you all are in good health. This is Shreya Jadhav welcoming you all to my e-learning channel. And today, we are going to learn English, grade 12, supplementary reading 4, The Enemy, written by Pearl S. Buck. This is part 3 of chapter number 4. So, let us know something about the author. Pearl S. Buck, born on June 26, 1892, died on March 6, 1973, also known by her Chinese name Sai Zhenzhu, was an American writer and novelist. As a daughter of missionary, Buck spent most of her childhood in China. Her novel, The Good Earth, was the best-selling fiction book in the United States in 1931-32. She was awarded the Nobel Prize in Literature for her rich and truly epic descriptions of peasants' life in China and for her biographical masterpieces. She was the first American woman to win the Nobel Prize for Literature. So now let us move to the introduction for answer. Dear students, always start your answer with introduction. This creates good impact. Rose. Rose name, The Enemy. Author's name, Pearl Buck. Genre, short story. Summary. Dr. Sada was a famous Japanese surgeon and scientist. How he manages to fulfill his career and patriotism is highlighted in this chapter. So now we shall proceed with the reading and explanation of the chapter. Henna considered this doubtfully, and when she did not answer, Sadao turned away. At any rate, something must be done with him, he said, and first he must be washed. He went quickly out of the room and Henna came behind him. She did not wish to be left alone with the white man. He was the first she had seen since she left America, and now he seemed to have nothing to do with those whom she had known there. Here he was her enemy, a menace, living or dead. She turned to the nursery and called Yumi, but the children heard her voice and she had to go in for a moment and smile at them and play with the baby boy, now nearly 3 months old. Over the baby's soft black hair, she motioned her with mouth, "Yumi, come in." "I will put the baby to bed," Yumi replied. "He is ready." She went with Yumi into the bedroom next to the nursery and stood with the boy in her arms while Yumi spread the sleeping quilts on the floor and laid the baby between them. Then Henna led the way quickly and softly to the kitchen. The two servants were frightened at what their master had just told them. The old gardener, who was also a house servant, pulled the few hair off his upper lip. So now eventually what happened? That both Sadao told that the person is supposed to be washed because he was really very dirty, because he was lying down on the mud and he was staining with blood and mud both. So he was supposed to be washed. Henna refused to do. He told that no, you should not do it. So both Sadao and Henna went out to fetch the servants so that they could convince him to do the work. But certainly none of them got ready. We'll get to know this further. And at that time duration, Yumi was with the children. she was, you know, having helping them out to sleep in their nursery. And at that time duration, Hannah took the children and she told that no, she wanted to say something, wanted to let them know about a thing which has just happened with them. And when the servants came to knew, they were a bit, we can say, more tensed to actually what has happened. The master ought not to heal the wound of this white man, he said bluntly to Hannah. The white man ought to die. First he was shot, then the sea caught him and wounded him with her rocks. If the master heals what the gun did and what the sea did, they will take revenge on us. I will tell him what you say, Hannah replied courteously. But she herself was also frightened, although she was not superstitious as the old man was. So there was an old gardener who was the servant of the family when Dr. Sada was a child. And he told, no, very bluntly, very straightforwardly, he said that if the master is going to keep the white man over here, no, first he was wounded with the gun, then he was wounded with the sea, and then he was wounded with the rocks. Now this means that the nature is also not helping him to save. Yes, they all wanted him to die. And if the people are going to, no, save him, then somehow it is for sure that there might be a reason that it would, no, hurt them back in some way or another. Hannah was also frightened about this thing, but she was not superstitious like others. Could it ever be well to help an enemy? Nevertheless, she told Yumi to fetch the hot water and bring it to the room where the white man was. She went ahead and slid back the partitions. Sadao was not yet there. Yumi, following, put down her wooden bucket. Then she went over to the white man. When she saw him, her thick lips folded themselves into stubbornness. I have never washed a white man, she said, and I will not wash so dirty a one now. Hannah cried at her severely. You will do what your master commands you. There was so fierce a look of resistance upon Yumi's round dull face that Hannah felt unreasonably afraid. After all, if the servants should report something, that was not as it happened. So eventually what happened, that Yumi was supposed to clean, but she resisted. She said no, that in her life she had never cleaned, or she had never, no, even touched a single white person, and that was the first person, the white man, whom she was supposed to wash. She refused at that time duration, that she was not comfortable in doing that. At that time, Hannah forced her by telling loudly, she shouted that whatever your master commands, you are supposed to fulfill it. You can never say no to them. And after a certain time, after saying this thing, Hannah also thought that, for example, if the servants go and they complain that what has eventually happened, then it would be a big loss for them, and that what they will be reporting will not be actually a true facts also. Very well, she said with dignity. You understand, we only want to bring him to his senses so that we can turn him over as a prisoner. I will have nothing to do with it, Yumi said. I am a poor person and it is not my business. Then please, Hannah said gently, return to your own work. At once Yumi left the room, but this left Hannah with the white man alone. She might have been afraid too to stay had not her anger at Yumi's stubbornness now sustained her. Stupid Yumi, she muttered fiercely. Is anything but a man? and a wounded helpless man. In the conviction of her own superiority, she bent impulsively and untied the knotted rugs and that kept the white man covered. When she had his breast bare, she dipped a small clean towel that Yumi had brought into the steaming hot water and washed his face carefully. The man's skin, though rough with exposure, was of a fine texture and must have been very blonde when he was a child. So eventually what happened, Hannah thought that now we are not supposed to force any of the servants to do the work. And at that time duration, Yumi also told that, please forgive me, this is not my work. And she was really a poor fellow. She didn't wanted to indulge in all these sort of things. And at that time Hannah told that she could leave the place, she could continue, resume with her work. And alone, again Hannah was left alone with the white man. And she started getting off the robes from his body so that she could clean. And she saw that the man's skin was rough with all these exposure of sea and sand and rocks and everything. But still, he was having a really fine texture and must have been very blonde when the white man was a child. While she was thinking these thoughts, though not really liking the man, better now that he has no longer a child, she kept on washing him until his upper body was quite clean. But she dared not turn him over. Where was Sadav? Now her anger was ebbing and she was anxious again and again, and she rose, whipping her hand on a wrong towel. Then, lest the men be chilled, she put the quilt over him. Sadav, she said softly. He had been about to come in when she called. His hand has been on the door and now he opened it. She saw that he has brought his surgeon's emergency bag and that he wore a surgeon's coat. You have decided to operate, she cried. Yes, he said softly. He turned his back to her and unfolded a sterilized towel upon the floor of the Tokonoma alcove and put his instruments upon it. Fetch towels, she said. She went obediently, but how anxious now. Two linen sleeves she took out the towels. There ought also to be old pieces of matting so that the blood would not ruin the fine floor covering. She went out to the back veranda where the gardener kept strips of matting with which to protect delicate shrubs on cold nights and took an armful of them. But when she went back into the room, she saw this was the old man's wound and had ruined the mat under him. Oh, the mat, she cried. Yes, it is ruined, Sadav replied, as though he did not care. Help me to turn him, he commanded her. She obeyed him without a word, and he began to wash the man's back carefully. Yumi would not wash him, she said. Did you wash him then? Sadav asked, not stopping for a moment to Swiss conscience moments. Yes, he did not seem to hear her, but she was used to the absorption when he was at work. She wondered for. So now eventually what happened? That slowly and gradually they started, Sadav came, she was waiting, and Sadav was dressed up in a surgeon's clothes and had his emergency bag. Moreover to that, both of them were really very frightened of what eventually was going to happen. But somehow they managed to balance it. Moreover to that, he told that he was supposed to turn the person on his back so that they could wash him well. And without uttering a single sound, why, what, no questions asked, Hannah would always was eager to help. She wondered for a moment if it mattered to him what was the body upon which he worked, so long as it was for the work he did so excellently. "You will have to give the anesthetic if he needs it," he said. "I?" she repeated blankly. "But never have I." "It is easy enough," he said impatiently. He was taking out the packing now, and the blood began to flow more quickly. He peered into the wound with the bright surgeon's light and fastened on his forehead. "The bullet is still there," he said, now with cool interest. "Now I wonder how deep this rock wound is. If it is not too deep, it may be that I can get the bullet. But the bleeding is not superficial. He has lost much blood." So eventually what happened? That he brightened up his light and he started looking. And the bullet was still inside his body. And when he tried to remove it out somehow, he saw that certainly that the bullet was very deep inside. And because of the rock, he was wounded more. And his bleeding was also not stopping. Dr. Sadao said that he must have lost a lot of blood. At this moment, Hannah choked. He looked up and saw her face the color of sulfur. "Don't faint," he said sharply. He did not put down his exploring instrument. "If I stop now, the men will surely die." She clapped her hands to her mouth and leaped up and ran out of the room. Outside in the garden, he heard her retching, but he went on with his work. "It will be better for her to empty her stomach," he thought. He had forgotten that, of course, she had never seen an operation. But her distress and his inability to go to her at once made him impatient and terrible with his man who lay like a dead under his knife. So eventually now what happened? When Hannah saw such a lot of blood, Hannah choked herself and she looked as if her face was like a sulfur. Moreover to that, he said that please don't faint and don't do anything, because he needed anesthesia for that. And Hannah was supposed to give anesthetic. And she clapped her hands in front of her mouth and she just ran outside. At that time, doctors told that it is better for her to empty her stomach out. And but he never thought that Hannah was attending this for the very first time. She was not having any sort of idea of how the things are supposed to be managed. And he just only observed and thought about one thing, that is that how this man was dying dead under his knife. That was the only thought which was going on inside his head. "This man," he thought, "there is no reason under heaven why he should live." Unconsciously, this thought made him ruthless and he proceeded swiftly. In his dream, the man moaned, but Sadao paid no heed except a mutter at him. "Groan," he muttered. "Groan is like you. I'm not doing this for my own pleasure. In fact, I do not know why am I doing it." The door opened and there was Hannah again. "Where is the anesthetic?" she asked in a clear voice. Sadao motioned with his chin. "It is as well that you came back," he said. "This fellow is beginning to stir." She had the bottle and some cotton in her hand. "But how shall I do it?" she asked. "Simply stirrate the cotton and hold it near his nostril," Sadao replied without delaying for one moment to intricate detail of his work. "When he breathes badly, move it away a little." So now eventually what happened? That Hannah was now feeling better and she thought that she was only supposed to help Sadao in this condition. None of the servants were also ready to help her out, help them out eventually. So they went, and at that time duration, Sadao was thinking that what is the reason that we are helping this man, this white man who has no connection with us. But still, at that time, Dr. Sadhav thought that no, I'm not supposed to think personally of who this person is. A body is in front of me, and as a doctor, I am supposed to treat the body well. And at that time duration, the door opened and Henna came inside, and she asked that, where is anesthetic, in a very clear voice. And at that time, just Sadhav motioned because he was busy in his surgery. And she came with the bottle and some cotton in her hand, and she saturated it. And Dr. Sadhav told that you are supposed to, you know, keep it near the nostrils. As soon as he starts more coughing, you can take it away from him. She closed to the sleeping face of the young American. It was piteously thin face, she thought, and the lips were twisted. The man was suffering, whether he knew it or not. Watching him, she wondered if the stories they heard sometimes of suffering of prisoners were true. They came like flickers of humor, but told word of mouth and always contradicted. In the newspaper, the reports were always that whenever the Japanese armies went, the people received them gladly with cries of joy at their liberation. But sometimes she remembered such men as General Takima, who at home beat his wife cruelly, though no one mentioned it now that he had fought so victoriously the battle in Manchuria. If a man like that could be so cruel to a woman in his power, would he not be cruel to one like this, for instance? So now, eventually what happened, that they were having a conversation, and she was not continuously thinking in her head that she had read plenty of times in her newspapers and articles and mouth-to-mouth conversation that how these people are being tortured up and they are being beaten up. And then at that time she is resembling that we have the head of the army, that is General Takima, how he eventually behaves and how, you know, cruelly he even beats up his wife. Then what is the reason? That obviously he is going to be cruel to his enemies also. She hoped anxiously that this young man had not been tortured. If it was at this moment that she observed deep red scars on his neck, just under the ears, those scars, she murmured, lifting her eyes to Sadhav, but he did not answer. At this moment, he felt the tip of his instrument strike against something hard, dangerously near the kidney. All thought left him. He left only the purest pleasure. He probed with his fingers, delicately, familiarly, with every atom of this human body. His old American professor of anatomy had seen to that knowledge. Ignorance of human body is the surgeon's cardinal skin, sirs. He had hundreds at his classes year after year to operate without as complete knowledge of the body as if you had made it. Anything less than that is murder. It is not quiet at the kidney, my friend, Sadhav murmured. It was his habit to murmur to the patient when he forgot himself in an operation. My friend, he always called his patients, so now he did, forgetting that this was his enemy. So now eventually what happened, Dr. Sadhav was not talking, means he had a habit of talking to his patients so that he could not divert his mind, and moreover to that he could operate well. And at that time Henna was also not more surprised because she had seen these sort of murmuring as Dr. Sadhav used to do. Then quickly, with the cleanest and the most precise of the Incisus, the bullet was out. The man quivered but was still unconscious. Nevertheless, he muttered a few English words. "Guts," he muttered, choking. "They got my guts, Sadao," Hena cried sharply. "Hush," Sadao said. The man sank again into silence so profound that Sadao took up his wrist, hating to touch of it. Yes, there was still a pulse so faint, so feeble, but enough. If he wanted the men to live, to give hope. "But certainly I do not want this man to leave," he thought. "No more anesthetic," told Henna. He turned as swiftly as though he had never paused, and from his medicines he chose a small vial and from it filled the hypodermic and thrust it into the patient's left arm. Then putting down the needle, he took the man's wrist again. The pulse under his fingers fluttered once or twice and then grew stronger. "This man will live in spite of all this," he said to Henna and sighed. The young man woke so weak his blue eyes were terrified when he perceived. So now eventually what happened? He found the bullet. It was at the back side and near his kidney. So doctor helped him to fetch it somehow. Nearly they got also, and he just removed the bullet. At that time duration, there was slight sounds coming out from the man. That pain, he could feel that. And eventually, the bullet was out. And at that time duration, the doctor said that you are not supposed to live, my dear friend, because you are enemy. But still, he was busy in his work, and Sadao replied and told Henna that now no more anesthetic is supposed to be given. Moreover to that, the medicines and some sort of injections were also given to him so that his pulses were supposed to be counted. Slowly and gradually, his pulses also increased, and now doctor said that this, in spite of all these odds, this person shall live at any condition and cost. This person is not going to die. And when that young man woke up, he was really very weak and he had blue eyes, and that was very terrifying. So dear students, we are keeping the chapter till here. In the next video lecture, we will continue from here itself. Thank you for watching and have a nice day. I hope that every one of you have understood till here. Goodbye, everyone.